fun.
Caught up in your presence.
That's right.
Yes.
Yes.
I just want to sit here at your feet. Caught up in this holy moment. Never want to leave.
Jesus.
And I'm not here for blessings.
Come on.
Yeah. Jesus, you don't hold. I just want you.
I was thinking about the fact that many of us haven't been inside a church building.
Thank you, Jesus.
For like 7-8 months. How powerful this song is. Like, Cody wrote this song, man. And
it's beautiful.
And he just kind of nailed it for me, like, the idea that we kind of go to church sometimes and hold God hostage, like the futility of that blows my mind. It always kind of has, but not having the luxury anymore of just going and going, let's see if the worship team can move me today. You know, let's see if they sing my jam, because if they sing my jam, God, I'm going to hook you up with a praise. I know how dumb that sounds, but like subconsciously we tend to do that. If they're doing a song we don't like or we don't know, we kind of end up like drinking our coffee and crossing our arms and scrolling on Instagram during worship. And I'm thinking about, man, when the world reopens, like fully reopens, the reset that has happened in our hearts that says, God, I'm so sorry for ever like making you compete with the very blessing that I asked for and you gave me. Like, God, I can't really do that. I can't really cross the street and speak to that person. I can't really give to this particular cause because, you know, I got these other things I got to handle. And, you know, that boat you blessed me with, I need to take it out Sunday. And so when I sing these words, I'm like, it's such a song of repentance and just scaling it back to what matters.
Yes.
Coming back to the heart of worship.
Yes.
And it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm so alone for the thing I made. When it's all about you're enough, take me back to where we
Caught up in the holy moment, that's welcoming him in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Welcome into this place. Welcome into you desire to abide in the praises of your people. So we lift our hands as we lift our hearts, as we offer up this praise unto your name. Welcome
into this broken vessel you desire. So Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true.
Prepare me. Prepare me, Lord, to be your sanctuary. Lord, come before you this morning, God. Humble, God. Prepare me, Lord. Prepare me, Lord. I want to live for you, Jesus. Dear Lord, we want to give you thanks this morning for another day, Father. Thank you, Father, that you have kept us. Father, it's my first time in the sanctuary since 2022. You have kept me through 2021, and I'm here now in 2022. I want to give you praise. I want to say thank you, Lord. Thank you, thank you, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. You have kept me. You have kept us, Lord. And we want to give you thanks. Father, we know it is a privilege. We know, Father, it's because of you're such a good, good Father and of your blessings on us. So we thank you this morning. JMCC, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you, Lord. We come before you this morning, Jesus, with a humble heart, Father. We ask you, Father, to prepare us for what you have for us today, God. Prepare our hearts, our mind, our body, our souls, God. Our minds, God. Keep us, Father, focused on you this morning, God. Help us, Father, to able to receive what you have for us today. For Father, we know you have something special for us. Father, you promised us, God, and you kept us. Father, we thank you. For our brothers and sisters, we thank you for our pastors, God. I ask you to bless them, continue to cover them, God. Continue to fill them afresh, Lord. Father, we stand here as a beacon on the hill, God. We thank you. We are few, God, but we know you have us here for a purpose. So we are waiting in expectation, God, for what you have for us. So we trust you, God. We love you. Thank you, Jesus, God. We know you loved us first. And because of the love you have for us, God, we are here. So we thank you. Father, we pray for this service this morning. For my pastor is going to bring this word this morning. I pray for a special touch for her this morning, God. I ask your Father to fill her afresh, God. Cleansing from the inside out, Jesus, this morning. Prepare her, God. That whatever she flows this morning will flow through us, God. Will be a food to our hearts, to our souls, God. And help us, Father, to just be prepared for it. Father, we thank you. We pray for all our other pastors this morning who are not here today. We ask you to cover them wherever they may be at this moment, God. Safety for them, God. Fill them afresh, Lord. And just keep them, God, under that bubble, God, safety. I pray for all my church brothers and sisters who are not in here this morning. For some reason or the other, God, we ask you, Father, to just cover them. We pray, Father, that wherever they may be, they will be able to hear this word, God, this morning that you have to pray for us, because I know it's all over the world, God. I was able to, in Panama, and I was able to tune in on Sunday mornings to see my pastors and my brothers and sisters with service, with praise and worship and everything. So I know you're all over. So we thank you for that. We thank you, we thank you, we thank you, Jesus. We pray for those who are sick this morning. I pray for healing, God. Continue, Father, to just touch their bodies. Father, just healing, because we know that you're a healer. We know that you're our everything. Anything we want you to be, you are. So, Father, I ask you to just help us, Father, to just focus on you and let you be the forefront of our lives, dear Jesus. Our children's lives, our grandchildren. Father, our great-grands, cover them, Jesus. Our mothers, fathers, husbands, wives. Put them all to you this morning. For, Father, we know that you are able. And for whatever the situation, whatever the spoken request, what is not spoken, you know our hearts, you know our minds, you know everything that goes through us, Father. So I ask your Father to just uplift us, God. Bless us, God. Cover us, God. I pray that your will be done in our lives. We thank you, God. We can't thank you enough. We pray for those who are there who might not have a home this morning. Bless them, cover them, God. Take them out of this cold, open a door for them, dear Jesus. We pray for those who don't know you, Father, that even one will hear a word this morning and want to know who you are. Father, we pray, Father, somebody walking down Washington Street this morning will say, let me come on in through this door. Father, we thank you. We just want to thank you through it all, Father, because you are such a good Father. There is none like you. So we have to give you all the praise and all the glory, and we want to say thank you again. And we want to say hallelujah. It's the highest praise. Hallelujah. He deserves it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We have lost so many loved ones, Father, what we are here. Father, we know it hurts, but we know that you are capable of strengthening us. Give us that inner strength, God, to go on each moment, Father. So we just want to thank you. Thank you for everything that goes for us in here this morning. Thank you for Wherever my pastor is this morning, God, I don't know if he's in, I don't know, but just cover him, God. Bless him, bless him, bless him. Bless his family, his home, God, our families. Cover them, God. Those who we know, even those we don't know, God. Those who are out there on the front line this morning, we put them to you. Those who are in authority for government, God, we put them in your hands. Because without you, God, nothing will work. So we thank you this morning. So God, we just thank you for your blessings and give you all the praise and all the glory. God, prepare us, Lord. Prepare us, Lord. We want to be sanctuary for you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen, amen. Good morning. We want to welcome all of those who are watching us from around the globe. We welcome our church members who cannot be present this morning. We welcome those who are watching or listening for the very first time. Although you are not here, we hope and pray that you'll be able to feel like you are with us and worshiping and listen to the teaching of the word. We look forward to meeting you when you come visit us in person. Also, welcome home, Sister Jenny. Welcome home. May this, thank you for tuning in, and may this service bless and touch your life.
Pam Wall, the ministerial staff, and the entire GMCC family, we welcome you who are joining us via the live streams and social media platforms, those of you who just recently found us and our regular viewers, and of course to everyone in the sanctuary with us here today. Thank you for cooperating with our social distancing and safety protocols. If you are logging on via bostonpraiseradio.tv, gmccboston.org, or Pastor's Facebook page, please be sure to leave your comments. We love hearing from you. Now, here's what's happening this week in church news. Please continue to pray for and send cards to those that are sick and shut in. Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 14 says, "Heal me, O Lord, and I shall be healed. Save me, and I shall be saved, for thou art my praise." Please continue to pray for healing for the following members: Pastor Karen, Brother Rashawn, Sister Sandra, Brother Richard, Sister Tina, and Brother Ulysses. Please also lift up Sister Edna's niece, Cheryl, who was in a car accident last Sunday. She is steadily improving and is out of the ICU, but she still has rehab ahead of her. As we continue to pray for you, please feel free to make your prayer concerns known by calling the church at 617-282-0685. Or by joining us for prayer on Monday through Friday at 6 a.m. and Saturday at 7 a.m. The number is 848-220-3100, and the access code is 313-131-31. Afternoon intercession, Monday through Friday, 12 to 12:30 p.m. You can call in at 978-990-5000, and the access code is 350-413-pound. For Thursday night prayer for our pastors, which meets at 8 p.m., the number is 848-220-3100, and the access code is 313-131-31. And on Fridays, you can join us for Friday night prayer meeting, which meets at 7 p.m. and can be seen on Pastor Bruce's Facebook page or by going to gmccboston.org and clicking the live stream. The annual church meeting via Zoom will be held next Sunday, January 30th at 3 p.m. Pastor Barbara will send out a link to all members. The ministry leadership meeting will be held on Saturday, February 5th, time to be determined. For additional information regarding church activities, please see your bulletin or visit our website, www.gmccboston.org. Until next week, everyone, have a blessed day and a wonderful week.
Ronald E. McNair, African-American physicist and astronaut. Dr. Ronald Irwin McNair was an African-American astronaut pioneer, along with Colonel Guyon Bluford. In 1983, Bluford became the first African-American to travel into space. In 1984, McNair became the second African-American astronaut to travel to outer space as the mission specialist aboard the Space Shuttle Challenger. Challenger made 128 orbits of the Earth on that trip. Ronald McNair was born in Lake City, South Carolina on October 21, 1950. He graduated in 1971, magna cum laude, from North Carolina A&T State University with a Bachelor of Science degree in physics. In 1976, at the age of 26, he graduated with honors from Massachusetts Institute of Technology with a PhD degree in laser physics. While a student at MIT, Ron McNair attended St. Paul's AME Church in Cambridge. And being a Christian and a black belt karate enthusiast, began a karate ministry at his church. It was through this ministry that our own Sensei Richard Scott met Ronald McNair and was inspired to start a karate ministry at his former church, 12 Baptist. This karate ministry continues until this very day at Global Ministries Christian Church. At MIT, McNair worked on the then recently invented chemical lasers and laser radiation. Later, McNair became a staff physicist at Hughes Research Laboratories in Malibu, California, where he continued studying lasers. In 1978, Ronald was selected as a mission specialist astronaut by the National Aeronautics and Space Administration, otherwise known as NASA. On his first space flight, he operated the shuttle's robotic arm to move a platform on which an astronaut could stand. This was the first time that such a mission was conducted. This method was used on subsequent shuttle missions to repair satellites and assemble the International Space Station. His final mission, which never occurred, was to launch the second tracking and data relay station and to release and pick up the Spartan Halley spacecraft using the robotic arm after the Spartan observed Halley's Comet during its closest approach to the sun. On January 28, 1986, 73 seconds after liftoff from Cape Canaveral, Florida, the Challenger exploded. All seven crew members did not survive. Ron McNair received several awards and honors during his short life of 35 years. Along with holding a fifth-degree black belt in karate, Ronald E. McNair was an accomplished jazz saxophonist, a loving husband, and a dedicated father to a daughter and a son.
Morning, church.
It's on. 2 Corinthians 9:6. Remember this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. Whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Each man should give what he has decided in his heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. Amen. This is time that we give back to the Lord what he has loaned to us, just a little percentage of it. For those of you who are in the sanctuary, please prepare your tithes and offering. For those of you who are at home, you can pay your tithes and offering in several manners. One way you can actually, if you have Push Pay or PayPal, you can actually pay your tithes and offering that way. Just go to, you can download it and pay it that way. You can also go to gmccboston.org/give and follow the prompts. Also for PayPal or Push Pay, you can actually text your tithes and offering to 77977, type GMCC give. You can do it that way. And lastly, you can actually mail in your tithes and offering to Global Ministries Boston, 670 Washington Street, Dorchester, Mass. 02124. Please, those who are here, please follow the directions of the ushers. Father God, I just thank you, Lord, that we're able to come into your house, Lord God. Lord, I ask that you bless the offering, Lord. May we give according to what we decided in our hearts. May we be cheerful givers, Lord. And as we receive the tithes and the offering, may we be good stewards of what you actually loaned to us. I thank you, Lord, and I praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
I'm not confusing the people up in the balcony, but I'm actually going to change gears with the song I was originally going to sing. I just feel that the Lord is leading me elsewhere with that. Sometimes even when we don't feel like praising, I just recall things that God has done for me, things that I've seen him do in my life and the lives of others. And I know there are people who are rejoicing this morning for protection and safety, and there are others who are searching for something from God and need a touch from God. And having been in both of those situations, sometimes you just need to say, well, praise is what I'm gonna do. Praise is who I am, and just push through and press for him. So this is what that song is, Praise is What I Do.
Because
God. Thank you, Lord. Praise you this morning.
Amen, amen, amen.
It's praise what you do. Then get on your feet. I don't care if you're at home in the bed. Get out of the bed.
Hallelujah.
Pull away from the counter. If praise is what you do, stand to your feet and give God the glory this morning. He didn't have to wake us up this morning, but he did. He didn't have to bring us through the week, but he did. Praise is what we do because he's worthy of it.
That's right.
There is none like him.
That's right.
Hallelujah. I don't know about you this morning, but God has kept me. He kept me when I didn't even want to be kept.
Oh.
So glory. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Whether times are good or whether times
That's
are bad,
right.
God, we're going to praise you.
Yes, Lord.
We're going to trust in you because you, oh God, are our hope. Hallelujah.
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 Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lord, we give you the highest praise this morning. If we had the tongues of 10,000 angels, it wouldn't be enough. We love you this morning. We glorify you.
Yes,
we give you honor. We give you praise, Lord. We bow down before you and
hallelujah.
We worship you this morning, God.
Hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah.
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 You can sit down if you want, but I gotta praise him for another moment. He's been good to me.
Take your time.
You don't know what I've been through. I can't praise him for you, but I can praise him for myself. Hallelujah this morning, God.
Glory.
Hallelujah.
Glory.
Hallelujah.
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 Glory be to God.
Hallelujah.
Glory be to God.
Oh, Jesus.
Glory be to God. Nobody else but you, oh God.
Hallelujah.
Oh, glory. We
glory
thank you.
Glory to your name, Jesus.
Jehovah Nissi.
Hallelujah.
Oh, Jehovah Jireh.
Hallelujah.
Our shalom.
Hallelujah.
Our peace.
Hallelujah.
Our lily in the valley.
Hallelujah.
Our bright and morning star.
Glory
we
to God.
We love you this morning, God.
Awesome, God.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you,
Hallelujah,
God.
Hallelujah, Jesus.
Thank you, God. Sister Corrine, I don't know why you changed the song this morning, but it was the moving of God. He needed
you,
to
Holy
remind
Spirit.
Us this morning. Doesn't matter what it looks like, we ought to praise him.
That's right. That's right.
Whether times are good or whether they are
That's
bad.
That's right.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Pray for me, my
Hallelujah.
Lord.
I will bless the Lord at all times.
Yes.
His praise shall continually be in my mouth.
Yes.
Oh, bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Father God, we come before you humbly and full of praise, Lord. Hallelujah. You told us that when we praise you, you inhabit the praises of your people. Father, now let me ask you for you to bless
yes.
and give a double portion of the anointing to my sister, my pastor, Barbara. Lift her up, Lord. Remove any distractions whatsoever.
Yes,
and bring your word forth, Lord. And by the end, as you bless all of the people here, may you be honored, praised, and given all the glory.
Yes, God.
In your son's precious name, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Praise God. Praise God. I haven't been here for a while. Last Sunday was my first Sunday back. I praise God. Thank God he took me off my sick bed. Amen. I thank God for it. Vaccine boosted up and still got COVID. And it wiped me out for a while. But praise God, he renews our strength. Amen. He allows us to mount up with wings like an eagle. Before we get into the word this morning, I want us to do something. And one of the reasons I've been praising God is today is Sister Tina Lee's birthday. Amen. God's been good to her. She's been in the hospital rehab for over a year. Can you imagine that? I was struggling with 2 weeks with COVID, but God has kept her. I remember when I got the call that she had had her stroke and she couldn't even swipe left on her phone, couldn't feed herself, couldn't move anything but her head and a few of her toes. She's walking, hallelujah. She's praising God this morning. She went and got her hair done yesterday and sent me some pictures. She's moving, and next weekend, if Jesus tarries, she'll be leaving the hospital and moving into her new apartment. Tell me God doesn't deserve to be glorified. The doctors have told her they've not seen people come back from where she was at. Nobody but Jesus. He still is the bomb in Gilead, Tina. He still is the bomb in Gilead. He still heals the sick. And he still raises up the dead. Amen, amen. Corinne, could you bring me my water from there? So we wish you happy birthday. We're gonna sing happy birthday too. Is that all right? She's tuned in this morning, so let's sing. Happy birthday to you. Thank you. To Tina, happy birthday to you. Amen. God is good. God is good. God had put it on my heart this year that because, you know, ministry was really scaled down because of COVID and the pandemic to allow people to send in some of their testimonies. I want you to know that as I was reading them, I would weep sometimes. Not tears of sadness, but of joy of what God has brought people through. So thank you to all of those individuals that have sent in their testimonies. I know that the congregation and the fellowship will be blessed. Tomorrow is the absolute deadline. If you haven't gotten your report in, or if you still want to send a testimony, tomorrow is it, because it's going to take me the entire week to put everything together. So again, tomorrow is the absolute deadline. Amen? Let's get into the word. Did we read the word this morning? I didn't think so. I thought, well, was I in the zone, in the spirit, and missed it? I didn't know. So get your Bibles out. We're going to be reading from the book of John, the fourth gospel of the New Testament, John chapter 14, and I'll read verses 1 through 14. please stand if you are able-bodied. Even if you're at home, we're going to ask that you stand in honor of God's word. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself. And where I am, there you may also be. And where I go, you know, and the way you know. Thomas says to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going, and how can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. And from now on, you know him and have seen him. Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father, and it is sufficient for us. Jesus said to him, have I been with you so long, and yet you have not known me, Philip? He who has seen me has seen the Father. So how can you say, show us the Father? Do you not believe that I am in the Father and the Father in me? The words that I speak to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me does the works. Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father in me, or else believe me for the sake of the works themselves. Most assuredly, I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also. And greater works than these he will do, because I go to my Father. And whatever you ask in my name, that I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it. May the Lord add a blessing and understanding to the reading of his word this morning. Amen. You may be seated. So, forgive me if I sip on my water this morning. I usually don't, but I'm still have a lingering cough from when I was sick, but I am negative. I'm not contagious. Just want all y'all to know that, not let the enemies put stuff in your head. Amen. So, Pastor had asked the ministers to enter into a series of preaching about hope. And if you've been with us the past few weeks, that's what we've been doing. They've been doing, and this is my first Sunday. And I started thinking about what hope was and why Pastor was being led of the Spirit of God that we should enter into this series and this topic. Well, it didn't take much to think about. I thought about 2020 in March when virtually around the world things shut down because of a pandemic that hit, a worldwide pandemic. I had never lived through something like that, that I knew about and understood and experienced. We saw during 2021 how all of the vulnerability of all the institutions we depend upon, the financial institution, the educational institution, the healthcare institution. This world pandemic impacted all of them, and we saw how they intersected with one another, and even economically, things were impacted. We're now experiencing in 2022 the impact of so many lives at one time. Hundreds of thousands of lives being lost, more than we've seen in world wars. How it's impacted the workforce, shortage of manpower, scarcity of food. Never have I walked in supermarkets and saw shelves just bare, little meat to choose from. I have a friend that cans food, meat, and vegetables. I've told her, as soon as you will let me in your house, I need you to teach me how to do that. Because I'm not sure if things are gonna get much better. In fact, some folk are predicting they're only gonna get worse. And so you might wanna store up on some canned goods and some dry goods. And every time I shop, I buy toilet paper, whether I need it or not, because never again am I gonna be going store to store searching for toilet paper. We had that experience in 2021. I have family members calling me, can you take me to find some toilet paper? Who would have ever thought? We had to stay away from our loved ones. I have for a couple years been planning this big 60th birthday party. I had to cancel that. I saved a lot of money, so that wasn't too bad. Thank you. I said, I'll have it in 61 for my 61st birthday, and that came, and we were still dealing with a world pandemic. So why do we need to preach about hope? So I thought about it. And I thought, what is the basis of hope? And that's the title of our message this morning. And the first thing I want to share with you is that there is a command to hope. Did you know that? There is a command to hope. Like faith, God tells us to have hope. He says in Psalms 131, O Israel, hope in the Lord. For this time forth and forever. Then it goes on to say in another Psalms, I think it's 62:5, says, my soul, wait in silence for God only, for my hope is from him. Instruct those who are rich in this present world not to be conceited or to fix their hope on the uncertainty of riches, but on God, who richly supplies us with all things to enjoy. That's from 1 Timothy 6:17. Didn't matter how much money I had, I couldn't find toilet paper. Doesn't matter how much money you had, if there's no meat, there's no meat. Scripture tells us right here, don't put your hope, don't fix it on the uncertainty of riches. Goes on, scripture says, therefore, gird your minds for action. Keep sober in spirit. Fix your hope completely on the grace to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. 1 Peter 1:13. I want you to know this morning, the hope that I'm talking about is not the wishful hope, the where you wish for something, but there's nothing to which you can really anchor that hope in. I admit occasionally I have hoped I'd hit the lottery, but you gotta play to even hit. That was just wishful thinking. That's not the hope I'm talking about this morning. The hope I'm talking about is Christian hope, biblical hope. Christian hope is a confidence that something will come to pass because God has promised it will come to pass. Somebody say amen. You see, that kind of hope is anchored in God. Hope is a characteristic of man. It belongs to his very nature. While there is life, there is hope, one Roman poet wrote. He who is joined with all the living has hope. That's Ecclesiastes 9:4.
So it characterizes the living. While man is alive, he can hope. And I want you to hear me this morning, saints, and even those who might not yet believe in Jesus Christ, that you've got to anchor your hope in him. And this is why the enemy tries to rob you of hope. Because if he can get you to take your own life out, if he can get you to feel hopeless, then there's no opportunity for you to enter into true hope. Hope is for the living. Hear me now. So this morning I'm encouraging you to hold on. Our message this morning is titled A Basis for Hope, and I've chosen the text John 14 and verses 1 through 14, and you might think that's an odd scripture for this message, but I believe the Holy Spirit will give you the insight that he gave me. This text is frequently read at funerals. Often the ministers will come down the aisle and begin reading this text. It contains hope and promises that are comforting in the face of death of a loved one. It's an appropriate text for a funeral, and it would be used this way because Jesus spoke these words as he himself was preparing for his own death, with the full knowledge that his disciples would soon be overcome with grief and difficulties. However, it's important for you this morning to understand that this text is not only about life after death, but it is a text that has everything to do with our lives here and now. I believe we can find the basis of hope in these scriptures as we face the daunting difficulties of this life here and now. Before we dive into chapter 14, I want to give you a little context from chapter 13 of the book of John. In chapter 13, we find the setting in which Jesus is basically giving his farewell address at his Last Supper with his disciples. Jesus has washed the disciples' feet, and he's explained to them what this means. You'll see that in verses 1 through 20 of chapter 13. Study it this week. He shares that he would be betrayed by Judas, and we see in scripture that Judas slips out into the night. Jesus also tells his disciples that he will only be with them for a little while longer, and that where he's going, they can't come. You see that in 13, verse 33. And lastly, in chapter 13, he has also foretold them that Peter imminently was going to deny him, verses 36 through 38. When you think about all of this, I want you to think about it for a moment. That here the disciples were in a room with Jesus, their beloved teacher, their Messiah. And he's telling them that he's going to be leaving them. And think of a loved one that you didn't want to go away, didn't want to move away, what you experienced. The sadness, the concern. They're experiencing this. Not only does it tell them that in a little while he's going to be leaving them, but that one of their own was going to turn against them. And then not only that, that another one of their comrades, their brothers in Christ, another disciple was going to be disloyal and would betray and deny that he even knew Jesus. Think about what they must have been thinking and feeling and experiencing. Scripture does not tell us what or how the disciples are fully feeling, but one can imagine that they were worried and disheartened and even maybe a little confused, and that anxiety was building up in them because of all that had just been poured out and said and transpired in chapter 13. So no wonder chapter 14 opens up with Jesus saying to them, "Let not your heart be troubled." You see, God senses the anxiety that's building up in them. He says, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me." Oh, I love that. I want you to repeat it after me. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. I don't know about you this morning, but that right there speaks to me. It calms me down. Let not your heart be troubled. Doesn't matter what you just heard. Doesn't matter what's been going on. Doesn't matter what the future holds. Let not your heart be troubled. Hallelujah. You believe in God, believe also in me. In other words, Jesus was saying to the disciples, I know that you don't fully understand all that I'm telling you right now, and that some difficult days are coming. I won't be able to walk and talk with you the way that you've been experiencing me these past 3 years, but don't let your heart be troubled. You've received me because you believed in God. You believed in the Old Testament and the promise that the Messiah will come. If you believe in God, believe also in me. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. Right there, Jesus calls them back to the fundamental relationship of trust and begins to assure them that he is not abandoning them. Hallelujah. So I want you to know that this morning, just as he assured the disciples that he's not abandoning them and that their hearts didn't need to be troubled, that's his word to you this morning. He has not abandoned you and he will not abandon you. If you believe in God, believe also in him. So whatever you're going through this morning, in the midst of a world pandemic, there is still hope. And the basis of our hope is our relationship with God through Jesus Christ. We can trust that Jesus, that just as Jesus told his disciples, he would be with them. He wasn't abandoning them. They could trust him. We can do the same. In verse 2, he goes on to say, in my Father's house are many mansions. Now remember in chapter 13, he told them, I'm getting ready to leave, but you can't go with me. This isn't a contradiction, what he's trying to tell them, because see, they were used to following on what my mother would say, you just hang on my coattail. They were hanging on his robe. Everywhere Jesus went, they went right with him. And he was letting them know, you can't go this time. You can't go right now, but he tells us in chapter 14, verse 2, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. See, again, you can trust me. I go to prepare a place for you. You see, yes, I'm leaving you, and you can't come right now, but I want you to know I'm going to get things ready for you. Hallelujah. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself. Amen. He's letting them know that I'm going to go and I'm going to prepare a place for you, but I'm not going to leave you on your own to get there. I'm coming back to get you. Oh, get excited, my children. He says, I'll receive you to myself, and where I am, there you may be also. In other words, he's assuring them that we're going to be together again. The foundation of hope is rooted in the character of God and his redemptive love for us. John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever would believe in him, whoever would believe in Jesus, would have eternal life. This is the essence of what Jesus is saying to them now. God is the basis of hope because of his own character. We can trust in God. We can believe in Jesus because the character of God, he cannot lie to himself or to man. The word of God says that God is not slack. He is not like man. He is true to his promise. But because God's redemptive love for his children, for his creation, that he would send his only son to take on flesh, to dwell among men, to bear the burden of sin, though he knew no sin. Let your heart not be troubled. You that believe in God, believe also in me. This is what we anchor our hope in. Not in money, not in status, not in education, not in friendships, sororities, or fraternities, but in the character of God, in his past deeds of salvation, and in his covenant to reconcile us unto himself. Therefore, the basis of our hope is that Jesus assures his disciples that he will return. Somebody say amen. I'm so glad this world is not my home, that I'm just a pilgrim down here journeying, that this is not it for me. This is but my training ground to learn how to praise him. So when I get to glory, I can really say praise is what I do. He assures his disciples that he will return, and where he's going, he is also our destination to be with the Father. Verse 4 goes on to say that, and where I go, you know, and the way you know. And Thomas said to him, Lord, we don't know where you are going, and how can we know the way? See, Thomas, you know, we call him Doubting Thomas. Thomas is like, I don't want to miss this. So make it clear to me. Thomas wanted a map with some directions. He wanted to put navigation in so that he could be sure he could get there. So he wasn't going to let Jesus just make that statement and go on. He's not, wait a minute, I don't know where you're going. And I don't know how to get there. Jesus says to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. See, in other words, what Jesus was trying to tell Thomas, it's not about a set of directions, but it's about trusting in me. It's about that intimate relationship that you have in me. I'm the way, and I will guide you with truth, amen? You don't have to worry about being deceived or blindsided or lied to. He says, I am the way. Follow me and you will get to where you ought to be. Because I am the truth. I am the Son of God who was sent to earth on your behalf. I am the way, the truth, and the life. Word of God says that I've come that you might have life and have that more abundantly. No one comes to the Father except through me. Many people will use that part of the verse as an exclusionary thing, that you can't get to the Father except through Jesus Christ, and though that is true, but this morning I want to broaden that text and help you understand that that is also a promise made to us through God. That in me, you will get to the Father. Because the Father is in him. This also is the basis of our hope, that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. This statement by Jesus is a promise, a word of comfort to his disciples and to us this morning. He's the map, he's the road to reconciliation with God the Father. He is our ultimate destination of eternal life. Hallelujah. Jesus adds, if you know me, you will know my Father also. The conditional phrase in Greek is a condition of fact, meaning that the condition is understood already to be true. So he's not asking a question here. It says, if you know me, in other words, it says, and you do, you will know my Father also. You want to know the heart of God? Get to know Jesus. You want to understand God's will for your life? Get to know Jesus. If you know me, you will know the Father. And if we know the Father, then that's our opportunity to experience the redemptive love of Jesus, of the Father through Jesus. So Jesus then moves away from talking about going away and returning in verses 3 and 4 to again asking them to trust and to believe that he and the Father are one. To see Jesus is to see the Father. And they have seen Jesus' face. They've walked with him. They've journeyed with him. They've heard his voice and his message. And even more importantly, they've seen the miracles that he has performed. The basis of our hope this morning is that we too have seen the miracles that God has performed. We hear his voice through his word every time we pick it up. Amen? When his Holy Spirit speaks to us and communes with us and walks with us and guides us. But I want you to know that the basis of our hope is to know Jesus and to know God the Father. When I think about miracles, Glenette, I think about Beverly and what God has done. When I think about miracles, I think about Sandra Hamlin and what God has done. When I think about miracles, I think about Scotty and how God has kept him and sustained him. I think about Tina, who couldn't even move or press a button on a cell phone, can now move, walk, and talk, and call you up and get mad if you don't call her back. God is still in the miracle business. He's performing miracles each and every day. When I think about how the doctor said I would lose my mind, I'm in my right mind. God is still in the miracle business. When my heart was broken and I thought it would never heal, but it did heal, God is still in the miracle business. The basis of our hope is the evidence that we've seen and that we've experienced in our life with Christ. God's mission for Jesus was to come into the world to help us know and understand God the Father and his redemptive love for us. This is the whole of Jesus' mission, to make known the Father, to reveal who God is. And Jesus, who has come from the Father, is now about to return to the Father. This is the fullest revelation of the person and the character of who God is. If we want to know who God is, we need to look no further than Jesus. All the words that Jesus has spoken and all the works that he has done comes from God and shows us who God is. He's a loving God. He's a just God. He's a faithful God. He's an on-time God. May not come when you want him or when you think he ought to. Oh, Tina, I'm talking about you this morning. Her and I had a few difficult conversations because God wasn't moving the way she wanted him to move, but God has moved. That very moment when you're about to give up, know that your blessing, your deliverance is right around the corner. So hold on this morning. Hold on to your hope in Jesus Christ. Know that your deliverance is coming. That breakthrough for that prayer you've been praying every day, for that cry that you've cried out to God, know that God has heard it, that he has been moved, that he himself has inclined his ear to your prayers. I want you to know this morning that faith and hope are complementary to one another. Faith is grounded in the reality of the past, and hope is looking to the reality of the future. Amen. I don't know about you, but I'm looking for his return. I want him to come back and take me home. This is not my home. I'm just a pilgrim journeying here. Without faith, there is no hope. And without hope, there is no true faith. Christians are people of faith and hope. And we have been passed down the mission that God gave to Jesus to help others come to know him, to be reconciled to him through Jesus Christ. Christians are people of faith and hope. We need to show that and demonstrate it and live it out, even in the midst of a world pandemic. Even if we don't know how our rent's gonna be paid, even if we're concerned about getting COVID, God can keep you. And here's the beauty about it. Even if you do die, you're gonna live again. You're gonna be with Jesus. You're gonna have the opportunity to praise him all day. We have the hope of eternal life, which God has promised to us. It says, we have the hope of eternal life, which God, who does not lie, promised before the beginning of time. That's in Titus 1:2. I want you to understand that this passage this morning in John chapter 14 has everything to do with the life here and now, because Jesus has now entrusted his mission to his disciples, and we are his disciples. It says, very truly I tell you, the one who believes in me will also do the works that I do. And then I love it. We're not only going to do what Jesus did, he says, but in fact, we'll do greater works than these, because I am going to the Father. I will do whatever you ask in my name. We have direct access to God the Father through Jesus Christ. That's power, y'all. That's authority. That's access. So that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If in my name you ask me for anything, I will do it. Now, let me just, for some of y'all that like to, you know, go a little far with this, let's be clear. When we're asking something of the Father, it's because we're aligned with the moving of the Holy Spirit that is in us. We're attuned to his word. And God shapes our will, amen, to his will for our lives. So those things that we are asking for are according to his will and his plan for our lives. See, because of the character of God and because of his redemptive love for us, he's not going to give us anything that's going to harm us or hurt us, even if we ask for it. So that brother you've been looking at that don't know Jesus, you can ask God for that, but he ain't giving that to you. Don't look for what God hasn't sent you. Jesus promises to be with us through the power of the Spirit, to work in and through us to accomplish his purpose in this world. This does not necessarily happen easily. It is not easily visible. It's not always going to be in spectacular ways. Yet wherever there is healing, wherever there's reconciliation, wherever there's life-giving work happening, this is the work of God. When somebody makes it through the day just because you gave them a word of hope and a word of encouragement. When somebody's able to hold on a little longer because you prayed with them. Or you shared your testimony of how God kept you, how God brought you through. This is the work of God. This is the presence of Jesus in us as he is in the Father. Did you know there are nearly 150 verses in the Bible that speak of hope? I'm going to share just a couple with you. Colossians 1:27 says, Christ in you is the hope of glory. Romans 8:23 through 25 says and speaks to all creation hopes for redemption. Hebrews 11:1 says, faith is the substance of things hoped for. 1 Corinthians 15:19 says, if in this life only we have hope in Christ. And in 1 Peter 1:13 says, be sober and hope to the end. Whatever the end is, hope to the end. Our hope is rooted and anchored in Christ. It is not a baseless hope. It is a hope that comes out of the character of God. It is the gift that he's given us to help us get through difficult times. No one has ever seen God. It is God, the only Son, who is close to the Father's heart, who has made him known. Jesus has made known to us the heart of God, and he has entrusted his mission of making God known to us. I encourage you this morning to fulfill the mission that God has called you to. I encourage you this morning to allow people to see the evidence of God's work in your life and through your life. I encourage you to think this week about how you might show others the very heart of God. This is the hope we have in Jesus Christ, that we are not in this alone, that our hearts don't have to be troubled, for we do believe in God, so we can believe in him. Amen, amen, and amen. I want to share, just in closing, I encourage you this week to read chapter 14 of the book of John. This is another message, but I'll leave this with you as a teaser, maybe. A cliffhanger, that's what they call it in the movies, right? But where he says in, excuse me, chapter 14, these things I've spoken to you while being present with you. But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all things that I said to you. In other words, he's saying, I'm not even relying on you to remember all this. I'm going to send you the Holy Spirit who will bring back to remembrance. And he says in verse 27, peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. You have heard me say to you, I am going away and coming back to you. If you loved me, you would rejoice because I said, I am going to the Father, for my Father is greater than I. Amen. God bless you. Pastor Hobbs, if you could come and extend the invitation to receive Christ this morning. Our invitation is about receiving Christ to experience God's redemptive love through his Son, Jesus Christ. It's about having a hope that is anchored in your faith, amen? A hope that is anchored in the character of God that is faithful and true.
Amen, amen. The Bible tells us in John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him would never perish but have everlasting life. The Bible says in Romans 10:9-10, if you believe in your heart and you confess with your mouth that God has raised Jesus from the dead, you shall be saved. For with the heart man believes in righteousness, or the completed work of Jesus the Christ, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. There is no other name given under heaven to mankind that we must be saved. Again, Jesus said, I'm the way, I'm the truth, and I'm the life. And no one comes to God, the eternal Father, but the relationship with Jesus the Christ. We must repent, turn away from our disobedience. Are you ready to, by faith, to receive Jesus Christ into your life as your Savior and your Lord? Won't you say this prayer of invitation? Lord Jesus, I know that I'm a sinner. and I believe that you died for my sin. Right now, I turn from my sin. I open the door of my heart and life. I receive you, Jesus the Christ, as my Savior and my Lord. Thank you for forgiving me and giving me eternal life with you and abundant life in this life. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah. Welcome to the family of God. The angels in heaven are rejoicing over one soul that's invited Christ into their life. We, the beloved church, we are rejoicing with you as well. And we want to support you in that faith journey here at Global Ministries Christian Church. You can call us at 617-282-0685. Write us at 670 Washington Street, Dorchester, Mass.
Amen. We want you to let us know if you've made that prayer. We want to walk with you and help you grow in faith with the Lord. And we've already had one individual who's asked, can I be a member virtually? Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Right? Amen. Praise God. And so I want you to know that as a church, we've got to get ready to minister to those who are with us virtually. And there are going to be some of you that are going to be called into some leadership to handle that part of our ministry. So I pray that as we sit and grow in faith, that you are also getting ready. God is preparing you to do a work, amen, to help and fulfill the mission that has been passed on through Jesus Christ to his disciples. God bless you. Have a blessed week. Be full of hope and share your hope this week.
There's not a mountain too tall. There's not